Top drug distributors and a manufacturer have reached a last-minute deal with two Ohio counties to avoid going to trial. What they settled, coming up.
Facebook caught Russia and Iran trying to meddle in the upcoming 2020 election. What Mark Zuckerberg says will happen so something like this won't be an issue in the future.
Teachers in Chicago are on strike in hope of better conditions and better pay. Hear from one teacher expressing their goals. Your Monday edition of TV2 News starts right now.
This is TV2 News.
New developments in the death of a newborn at Hiram College and companies settling in an opioid lawsuit. That's where we start tonight. Good evening, Kent, and all of Portage County. I'm Kendra Hughley.
And I'm Rachel Gross.
Just as the federal trial over the opioid crisis was scheduled to begin today, three of the nation's most dominant drug distributors and a drug maker and Cuyahoga and Summit counties have settled a $260 million lawsuit. Lawsuits across the country have been filed to hold drug industry officials responsible for more than 400,000 deaths in the U.S. since 2000.
Ohio Attorney General Dave Yost reminded Ohioans of a new law prohibiting chiropractors and certain healthcare practitioners to call victims immediately after a car accident. These professionals now have to wait at least 30 days following the accident to contact the individual by call, text, or email. Professionals who violate this law will be fined $5,000 per violation and potentially lose their license. Victims and witnesses who are called before the 30-day grace period should contact the Attorney General's office at the number on the screen.
Ohio police are investigating after a body of a newborn baby was found inside a trash can at Hiram College. The baby was inside a garbage bag and was reported by a maintenance worker to Hiram police Friday morning. Following the fine, the dorm was put on lockdown. Hiram's president, Lori Volota, says the university is in mourning and shock. I have honestly loved the weather. I mean, I got a peak of sun today and I was happy to enjoy that.
Yeah, definitely a lot colder now. I'm wondering how long this weather is going to last and if we're going to see any sun later this week. Chris Grant is here to tell us more. Hi, Chris.
Thanks, Rachel. Let's talk about weather a little bit here. Weather, basically, it was a very nice day outside today. It was in the 70s. Right now we're seeing 68, so it's definitely cooling down a little bit. Didn't see that much sun today, but definitely I will still take it. It was a pretty dry day out there. And just taking a look throughout the rest of Ohio, they're seeing those warm temperatures as well. Mansfield at 70, Worcester also at 70, Canton a little higher at 71, and up north we have Sandusky at 63 and Cleveland at 69. Taking a look at tonight, temperatures will be dropping down to about 53 degrees, clouds as well as some wind gusts sticking around as well. And just taking a look at tomorrow, temperatures will be going back up a little bit to 62. However, that dry day we saw today won't be the same story tomorrow. We'll be seeing some rain early throughout the day, but that will be tapering off as we go throughout the day. Stick around to find out the full forecast for this week, though.
Thanks, Chris. Ohio is receiving a federal grant worth $42 million in efforts to improve child literacy in the state. The State Department of Education says that the funding will help implement improvement practices in elementary, middle, and high schools. Officials say the state got an extra $1.2 million to support pilot programs at three elementary schools to help improve the literacy of students who have dyslexia or are at risk.
U.S. Attorney Benjamin Glassman of Cincinnati will resign on November 1st for President Trump's new pick, veteran prosecutor David Delavers. Delavers is expected to be confirmed by the U.S. Senate and is backed by both Ohio Senators Rob Portman and Sherrod Brown. Glassman has not said what he plans to do next publicly.
An Ohio mother was horrified to wake up to find an intruder attempting to give her two-year-old son a bath. Arieka Hill stated that she saw a white woman bent over the tub with her son inside. Hill was able to get the woman away from her child, then her boyfriend restrained her until authorities arrived. The woman, 22-year-old Elizabeth Hickson, was arrested and charged with burglary.
It's dinner time. You may be eating or a pre or post snack right now, but how are those many meals affecting your body throughout the day?
Facebook caught two countries trying to meddle in the 2020 election. What Mark Zuckerberg is saying about the report.
And with Halloween getting closer, the only scary thing I see is the temperatures for this week. Find out all about it after the break.
It's not my first time bartending, so.
It's a sausage party in here.
It's fine. I'm very familiar.
Yeah, because you're a sexy girl, Sam. Last thing,
yeah,
is that the music, when Momo kicks it into high gear, is going to get a little bit loud in here. Mm-hmm. So your customers are going to have a hard time hearing you. So you may want to.
What?
Make sure
they don't
get too close.
It's a big responsibility.
Oh, it's huge. I know, it's huge.
And the salary.
Oh, my God, yes. Right? I mean, like, I was about to move in with my parents. And right before, so this saved me.
I really believe in you, you know?
Thank you. It's nice to hear that from someone.
These are cool. Did you, what did you?
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit theshelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
Welcome back. Facebook revealed new plans to prevent election interference in the 2020 United States election. The website will create more transparency in the origins of Facebook pages and label news stories that come from state-owned media. According to Mark Zuckerberg, Facebook has already prevented interference campaigns from Russia, Iran, and China. Facebook will now use automated systems that can identify foreign manipulation campaigns on the website. These new plans come in response to Russian interference campaigns on Facebook during the 2016 U.S. election.
300,000 students are home for the third day in a row today as the Chicago teachers' strike continues into another week. The Chicago Teachers Union and city officials negotiated throughout the weekend, but to no avail. The strike calls for smaller classes, support staff, raises, and additional school funding. Officials say their demands cannot be met due to funding issues.
After 2 days of school being canceled while we're on strike, we have seen movement and we've made some wins. It shouldn't take being on strike to get the needs of our students met. But again, as we've said repeatedly, we are looking for a just contract, a contract that addresses the needs of a school district that serves 90% students of color and students who live in challenging conditions and in low-income communities and homes who have their needs need to be addressed.
On Sunday, a tornado hit the northern area of Dallas, Texas. The storm caused power outages, damaged buildings, uprooted trees, and snapped power lines. Three people were taken to the hospital for storm-related injuries, but so far there are no fatalities. Preliminary ratings of the damage and power of the tornado will be conducted today and tomorrow.
The tornado in Dallas was scary. Now imagine trying to deliver your baby during it with no power. A mother delivered her newborn baby inside the laundry room of a bump birthing center on Sunday night. The center posted a status to their Facebook page saying, "Baby girl born in the laundry room with tornado sirens going off, or tornado on the ground and no electricity. Welcome to the world, beauty."
JP Morgan announced that they will begin hiring people who have criminal records. In a press release, CEO Jamie Dimon stated, quote, "When someone cannot get their foot in the door to compete for a job, it's bad for business and bad for communities that need access to economic opportunity." The United States currently loses between $78 and $87 billion in annual GDP from excluding people with prior conviction from the workforce.
And let's take a look throughout the rest of Northeast Ohio. Seeing some pretty warm temperatures throughout all of Ohio, except up in Lima, they're sitting up at 59. However, Dayton and Cincinnati are a little warmer with 71 and 69 respectively. So pretty warm all throughout Ohio. and just taking a look at tomorrow. We'll be, like I said earlier, we'll be capping out at around 62, some early morning showers at around 6 a.m. At around lunchtime, the sun will be coming up, but it will be hidden by some clouds. But it's definitely a still nice day to get out there. And just as this day comes to an end tomorrow around dinner time, we'll be seeing temperatures dip back down to 60 degrees. The sun will still be hidden behind those clouds, however, so definitely not too sunny tomorrow. And just taking a look at our 7-day forecast, temperatures are definitely going to be going all over the place as we go throughout the rest of this week. 62 tomorrow, 58 on Wednesday. However, the sun will be out in full effect as well on Thursday with 61. Taking a look at Friday, some showers will be coming back around, high of 52. And looking at the weekend, we have temperatures going to 56 on Saturday and 59 on Sunday. So definitely a little bit of a chilly weekend and a chilly start to next week as well with temperatures going to 62. So definitely a nice week to get out there, especially on Wednesday and Thursday with the sun sticking around. But definitely, like I said, a very good week for this time of year, especially.
Thanks, Chris. Well, the weather should be good for this. Orinoids. Ever heard of them? Orinoids are a type of meteor shower that appears every October when the Earth travels through an area of space littered with debris from the Halley's Comet. Now, you can only see this shower once a year, and it will be best visible for only 11 hours. The meteor is projected to be at its best around 5 a.m. Sky watchers should be able to see between 10 to 20 meteors per hour. If you stay up and get an early view of it, share a picture with us on Twitter at TV2KSU. And the Brex vote has been denied. Boris Johnson hoped to vote on the Brex deal today, but the Speaker of the House, John Bercow, blocked it. Votes on the government's withdrawal agreement bill will begin Tuesday.
Protests in Hong Kong are continuing into a fifth month. Protesters are disrupting public transportation, striking from jobs, and blocking roads. 24 people were hospitalized today in injuries directly related to the protests, and more than 224 flights were canceled after airport workers went on strike. The protests started in June against proposals that would allow extradition to China and have escalated ever since. And the biggest newspaper competitors in Australia acted on solidarity by publishing blacked-out front pages in their Monday editions. This move was to protest against press restrictions that have stifled reporting and gone against free press. In June, police raided the Australian Broadcasting Company over articles that relied on leaks from whistleblowers, and the government is still saying that some journalists may face backlash. Media organizations are demanding better freedom of information at a time where Australia is becoming one of the most secretive democracies in the world.
In Chile, thousands of protesters have taken to the streets with demonstrations taking place in Santiago and surrounding cities. So far, 11 people have died, 8 of which died on Sunday. Chileans are protesting a proposed transportation ticket price increase, as well as an income inequality and high cost of living.
Burger King was the first to release a fake meat sandwich, and we have the details on a new Burger King scary burger and Dunkin' Donuts going beyond meat. Stick with us.
Over the weekend, a member of the Flashes volleyball team set a new school record. I'll tell you who, how, and when we return in a flash.
Similar personalities, and this cat makes me make art, because he's always motivating me to take pictures of him, to draw pictures of him. He just is motivating artistically. It's just that simple. Well, he's my best friend, but a lot of people know him as Keyboard Cat.
Why is my son having trouble in school?
Finding lowest airfare to Istanbul.
No, I'm tired of fighting with my son over his homework.
Home, walk, restaurant. Need a review?
No. He's smart, but his mind wanders.
Seven wonders of the world.
Why don't you understand me?
I do. I was trying to show how Connor feels every day. Redirecting to understood.org.
Join parents and experts at understood.org, a free online resource about learning and attention issues to help your child thrive.
Hello everyone, Ben Pagani with you as always, and for all you bettors and bookmakers out there, you may need to hold the phone before getting too excited about placing bets on college games here in the Buckeye State. The Ohio Interuniversity Council expressed their concern to the Ohio House Finance Committee last week. As of right now, there is a bill in the House that would legalize betting on collegiate events in various organizations. Well, after suffering a tough defeat on Saturday to the Ohio Bobcats, Sean Lewis is preparing his men for a battle at home this weekend against Miami. All right, well, sorry about that, but we'll move on to the Flashes soccer team, who was home on Sunday against Central Michigan. CMU scored a quick goal just 3 minutes into the game, but the Flashes responded in the 30th minute when Vital Cat scored her eighth goal of the season to tie the game up at 1-1. The match went to double overtime, but neither team could find a way to win, and this contest ended in a tie. Flashes are now 5-7 and three ties that is, and will play 12-4 Ball State this Thursday. Well, on the volleyball court, sophomore libero Aaron Gardner became the youngest player in school history to achieve 1,000 digs. That dig came on Saturday in the second set as the Flashes completed an upset by sweeping the Ball State Cardinals. Gardner is ranked 9th in the nation in total digs and 5th in the nation in digs per set. She will now look to carry the Flashes as they have 5 away matches in a row. And the Kent State Golden Flashes field hockey team was riding a 5-game winning streak going into yesterday's matchup with Northwestern, but that's where it would end. Flashes were shut out by Northwestern with a final of 5-0. Flashes will look to start a new winning streak this Friday against Appalachian State University. Ohio State moved up another spot in the AP rankings this week. The Buckeyes jumped over Clemson to 3rd overall in the poll. The team dismantled Northwestern on Friday as they beat the Wildcats 2-3. The Buckeyes will play Wisconsin this Saturday. Wisconsin is coming off of their first loss of the season after an upset by 1 point to Illinois. We'll take a look right here. The Baltimore Ravens yesterday beat the Seattle Seahawks by a final score of 30-14, and that did not do the Browns any help. We'll look at the AFC North standings right now, and the Browns really needed a victory from the Seahawks yesterday because, well, they just weren't able to get any help. The Ravens now move to 5-2. The Steelers and Browns are tied for second and third place with 2-4 records, and the Cincinnati Bengals are lowly at 0-7 at the bottom of the standings. The Browns will play the Patriots this upcoming Sunday at 4:25. That's going to do it for sports. Be sure to tune in tonight at 8 for an all-live, all-new sports corner. Till then, I'm Ben Pagani.
Thank you, Ben. Now, you might not be aware that the vast majority of Kent State's student body is considered to be commuter students.
That's right. Our own Maddie Haberberger found out how one campus organization is honoring commuters. Maddie?
Thanks, Rachel and Kendra. Now, today kicked off Commuter Appreciation Week here on campus. Since thousands of students commute to campus every day, the university is able to provide all kinds of resources to commuter students. Check it out.
This week is Kent State's annual Commuter Appreciation Week. Commuters make up 80% of the Kent State student body. What some may not know is that a commuter is considered anyone who doesn't live on campus, meaning that those who live in off-campus apartments or houses are also considered commuters. The Commuter and Off-Campus Student Organization, or COSA, represents the commuter population here at Kent. According to Victoria Cantini, the Marketing and Public Relations Chair, they're using Commuter Appreciation Week as an opportunity to recognize students who commute and promote opportunities and resources offered to commuters.
Each day we're partnering with a Kent State service, so Monday was PARTA, Tuesday is Parking Services, Wednesday is COSO Day, and then Thursday is Dining Services.
As a commuter herself, Cantini thinks that COSO is a great way for students to stay active and up to date with campus happenings, even if they don't live on campus.
So many people do commute, and if you commute, you're not on campus all the time, so you can feel like left out and not involved, and a big part of college is staying involved and, you know, getting the best out of your 4 or 5 years here.
Not only does COSO offer support to commuter students, but they also provide resources to students who plan on moving off campus in the future. They also use their platform to ensure the safety of students who drive to campus.
Let's say there's a pothole on Summit and someone tells us about it, we can contact the university, for they can contact other people to get it fixed, because it does affect people, like when the road conditions aren't good. And that's a big thing we do.
For more information about COSO and the events they have planned for Commuter Appreciation Week, visit their website at kent.edu/COSO. Now, COSO will be tabling on the second floor of the Student Center through this Thursday of this week from 10 a.m. to 1:30 p.m. For TV2 News, I'm Maddie Haberberger.
Thanks, Maddie. The list of best colleges and universities in Ohio has been released. Let's be honest, we're all wondering where KSU ended up. Unfortunately, Kent State did not make the list, which was made by WaltHub.com. Results were based off of career outcomes, student-to-faculty ratio, graduation rate, and cost of financing. First on the list in Ohio is Case Western Reserve University, followed by the Ohio State University in Columbus. Rounding out the top 10 is the University of Cincinnati. While Kent State didn't make the list this year, there's always hope for next year.
Not sure what to do with your pumpkins once Halloween is over? Luckily, a Ravenna Animal Sanctuary is offering a solution. Happy Trails Farm Animal Sanctuary is asking for donations in the form of pumpkins for their animals, stating that they not only provide a tasty treat for the animals, but they're also a source of enrichment. Pigs at the sanctuary can get a workout by breaking open these pumpkins, Happy Trails states in a Facebook post. Anyone wishing to donate can deliver pumpkins to 5623 New Milford Road in Ravenna. And Cedar Point hit maximum capacity on Saturday for their Halloween events. The park had to turn guests away at the gate, urging them to come back the next day or even the next weekend. Overcongestion of vehicles led to Cedar Point Drive and Cedar Point Road to close. Amidst the congestion, a man was struck by a truck, leading to severe injuries, but police said he would be all right. On Sunday, the park drew less of a crowd, and officials said they did not turn anyone away on Sunday. Cedar Point's last weekend of operation is this weekend, October 26th and 27th.
All right, are you a constant snacker like me? Though sometimes, you know, snacking in the world may not be good for us, we have some tips on how to make your indulgences, a little more healthy. TV2 will be back in 90 seconds.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit the shelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
Patriotism. It inspires passionate debate. It's worn like a badge of honor with good reason. Because it means love and devotion for one's country. But what really makes up this country of ours? It's the people. To love America is to love all Americans. This year, patriotism shouldn't just be about pride of country. It should be about love, love beyond age, sexuality, disability, race, religion, and other labels. Because love has no labels.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit the shelterpetproject.org. Adopt. There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit the shelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
Welcome back. Google Maps will release new features designed to give drivers better visualization of road conditions. Hazards such as accidents, speed traps, and traffic slowdowns can be reported by users. Android users have been able to use these features already, but it was unavailable to iOS users. The new update was released last week.
Burger King is releasing yet another Halloween-themed burger. This year, the Ghost Whopper is taking center stage in only 10 Burger Kings across the country. The burger features a white cheddar cheese flavored sesame seed bun that appears white. Previous Halloween burgers have been the Nightmare King with a green bun in 2018 and the infamous Black Bun Burger in 2015. The Ghost Whopper will go on sale for $4.59 on October 24th, and unfortunately, no Burger King locations in Ohio will be receiving this Ghost Whopper.
Just like Burger King, Dunkin' is now getting all its stores in the U.S. to go beyond the meat with their new Beyond the Meat breakfast sandwich. The sandwich will be in all 9,000 U.S. stores starting November 6th. The chain already tested the sandwich in its Manhattan locations in July and decided to introduce it to all stores just months later.
If you've ever been in a newsroom, you know that we are constantly snacking. When energy lags and you need a snack to keep you going, it can be tempting to reach for something sugary instead of something good for you. Because there's so much temptation, snacking has a bad rap. But it doesn't have to be that way. Kim Hutcherson has more in today's Health Minute.
A healthy snack can provide energy in the middle of the day and keep you from overeating at mealtime. So try these healthy snack hacks. First and foremost, avoid the junk food. If you have to keep sugary snacks in your home, put them where they're hard to see or reach. Don't spend money on pre-packaged snacks. Buy healthful choices in bulk and divide out your portions yourself at home. This will keep you from eating too much at one time. It also allows you to tailor your snacks to your specific health needs, like subbing in unsalted nuts in homemade trail mix. Give your veggies a kick with healthy dips or spreads like hummus or tzatziki. Try to vary your vegetables to include green, red, and orange options. Bring your ready-to-eat snacks with you so you have power over your snack choices. Stock up on whole fruits like bananas, apples, and oranges. They're easy to throw into a bag and provide natural sugars rather than the processed kind. And give yourself a nutrient blast by combining food groups. Yogurt and berries, apples and peanut butter, or whole grain crackers with turkey and avocado. For today's Health Minute, I'm Kim Hutcherson.
Now all this talk about food and snacks makes me want to go get a snack of my own.
Rachel, stop playing. Stop playing around because, listen, I need the snacks. I always need the snacks.
Yeah, somebody dropped off a basket earlier and it was just hard to resist. Those Hershey Kisses, they red, green, and orange, they was for the wrapper colors, so okay, healthy to me.
Keeps you energized. We need it.
Yeah, throughout the day, definitely. And while walking to class in this weather that we're having, Chris, can you give us an update on the weather that we're going to be having this week?
Yeah, definitely a little bit all over the place. Like I said, we'll be seeing some rain tomorrow. However, Wednesday and Thursday, definitely a nice day to get out there. Enjoy that sunshine while it lasts because it seems to be becoming more and more sporadic. And as we move to the weekend, definitely Saturday is another good day to get out there. So definitely enjoy it while you can, guys, because winter is coming. I know people don't want to say the word, but snow will be here before you know it.
I don't know. I love the cold. I'm ready for it to be... What tomorrow? 60-something?
62.
Not 70 like today. Wasn't feeling that at all. I like to wear my flannels and whatever.
I'll keep it. I liked it.
Yeah, me too.
I'll keep it. This is our report for Monday evening. Thank you for joining us. And you can always find the latest headlines and breaking news on Kent Wired.
And it was a big sports weekend, so make sure to tune into an all-new episode of Sports Corner tonight at 8, only on TV2. I'm Rachel Gross.
And I'm Kendra Hughley. For all of us at Portage County's TV2, have a great night.
This is Portage County's TV2, broadcasting from the campus of Kent State University.